I'm Luke Painter. Today I'm going to discuss the order Rodentia, covering a few families of large rodents that have only one species in them in North America. And you'll recall in the video of the introduction to rodents, we talked about the varying skull conditions. We have three of those demonstrated here in this group of rodents, so we'll review that as well. Starting off with the Aplodontia rufa, the mountain beaver. This is in the family Aplodontiidae, and it's the only species in that family. It's considered a primitive rodent, which is not to slander it in any way. It just means that it probably represents some of the early rodents in terms of the some of its adaptations. And it has a skull condition that we've discussed before called protrogomorphous, and this is characterized by an infraorbital foramen that's fairly small and is not used to pass masseter muscle through, and not really much of a zygomatic plate developed here for muscle attachment, as we'll see in the sciuromorphous skulls. But another really good character for the Aplodontia rufa, which is called the mountain beaver, common name, sometimes boomer. They really have nothing to do with beavers, except that they gnaw on trees, small trees and plants, but that's their common name nonetheless. So the skull condition is a good identifying character because they're the only ones that have that skull condition. But in addition to that, their teeth are quite distinctive. Maybe I'll look at this specimen. It's got a little more contrast. And the teeth have little stems sticking off to the lingual side, the labial side, the cheek side, the outside of the teeth, little stems coming off. And this gives them a appearance that we sometimes describe in class as apple-shaped because they're round with a stem, and that helps you remember the name Aplodontia rufa, or the family Aplodontiidae. And this kind of points out also how with many of these families, most of the families have a type, genus, and species. And so in this case, the family Aplodontiidae, the type genus is Aplodontia, and then the species is Aplodontia rufa. And you'll see that in a lot of families, that there's one species that where the name is similar to the family name, and that then is the type genus for that family. All right, now we're going to move on to the beaver. This is the North American beaver. I'm going to turn it around here so you can see the tail. And here I have a juvenile. With the juvenile, you can see the same features. Fairly stout, large rodent with a flat, hairless tail, wide hairless tail. Nothing else has a tail like a beaver. They also have webbed feet. The front feet are not really as webbed as the hind feet. They're more like claws, but they're still somewhat wide. And the beaver, then, is in the family Castoridae. Castor canadensis is the American beaver. There's a European species also, the castor fiber. But in North America, just the one species, Castor canadensis. And looking at the beaver's skull, we see that the infraorbital foramen is quite small. It's almost like a little slit here. It's not being used to pass the masseter muscle. And there's this development on the front of the zygomatic arch and the side of the rostrum that we call the zygomatic plate, where muscle is attaching for the mandible. And so this condition then is the sciuromorphous condition, as I discussed in the other video. So beavers are sciuromorphous, as are most rodents. And then let's look at some other features of the beaver skull. The teeth are what I might call semi-prismatic. I mean, you could call them prismatic, but they're not very angular like we see in the family Cressetidae, but they are ridges of enamel that are kind of loopy, and then they have these little areas in between of the softer dentine, and they're very flat, so it creates that kind of file-like surface that's characteristic of the prismatic teeth. This particular tooth condition, this particular appearance of teeth is similar to what we find also in the the nutria and the porcupine, which we're going to look at in a moment. Another interesting thing about the beaver skull, besides just the fact that it's large and robust, for a rodent, quite stout, kind of heavy, larger than most rodents, there's also a feature here where the basioccipital bone is depressed. There's a bit of a, it's kind of a dimple in the basioccipital bone, which is another feature that's characteristic of the beaver skull. I think you can see that on this specimen as well, down in here. And if you can't quite pick that out, you're going to look at some of the specimens, photos on that we put online. All right, so that's the beaver. Let's move on now to the nutria, Myocastor coypus. In the family Myocastoridae, the nutria is an introduced species in North America. They're originally from South America, but they were introduced to North America for fur farming and then escaped and are now quite widespread and quite a problem as an invasive species. Nutria is the common name, coypu in South America. In Louisiana, sometimes they call them swamp rabbit, especially if they're trying to sell them in restaurants. But generally they're called nutria. They have some characteristics in common with the beaver. If we just look at the pelt for a moment, a large rodent, large aquatic rodent, luxurious fur with the guard hairs and warm underfur like you see in a beaver. The hind feet are webbed. The tail, though, is round and not very furry. It has a little bit of fur, but it's kind of a rat-like tail with guard hair fur on it, almost hairless down here at the tip and round. So that's a really clear distinctive feature between the nutria and the beaver that you can just pick out right off. Now let's talk about the skull for a moment. The nutria skull, as we discussed in previous video, is histricomorphous. It has a very large infraorbital foramen. If you didn't know what you're looking at, you might confuse the infraorbital foramen with the orbit, but the orbit's back here. This is the infraorbital foramen has enlarged and now is a passageway for masseter muscles attaching to the mandible. So the muscles come through here, attach to the side of the rostrum. The infraorbital foramen is now so large it's actually larger than the foramen magnum, which on most skulls is the biggest hole. And so the histricomorphous condition then is the nutria skull. We have one other large rodent that has this condition, the porcupine, which we'll look at in just a moment. A couple more things to notice about the nutria skull. The teeth, very similar to what I was describing with the beaver, kind of a prismatic or semi-prismatic with this flat file-like surface with the little enamel ridges. The skull is large and robust for a rodent. The parasitical processes on a nutria are quite long. I'm going to bring this beaver skull over here. So here's a beaver skull, short parasitical processes. Of course, there's other really important features. You shouldn't have any trouble distinguishing a beaver skull from a nutria skull because the nutria skull is histricomorphous. The beaver skull is siluromorphous. But when we get to the porcupine, I'm going to just pull the porcupine skull over here for a moment. The porcupine is also histricomorphous, but here's a clear difference between the porcupine and the nutria. The nutria, the parasitical process is quite long, and the porcupine it's short. And the way I remember this is that the nutria has a long tail and the porcupine has a short tail. And so that goes with the length of the parasitical processes. So nutria, histricomorphous with long parasitical processes, porcupine, histricomorphous with short parasitical processes. Here's a juvenile nutria. I'll just bring this in here for a moment. You can see some of the similar characteristics of the webbed hind feet, the long round tail that's a little furry but not very much and is thin. All right, so now we're going to move on to the porcupine. As I mentioned, the porcupine skull is histricomorphous. I think you can see the large infraorbital foramen there where the masseter muscle can pass through for attachment on the side of the rostrum. And as I just mentioned, it has the short periocipital process. Now, when you're comparing a Nutria skull and a porcupine skull, you're looking at a skull like this, you're trying to figure out if it is a Nutria or a porcupine. One thing you got to be careful about is that the periocipital processes on the Nutria, which I'm holding here, can break off. So you might just have little broken nubs there, and you don't want to be fooled by that. But on this porcupine skull, there's a nice periocipital process right here that comes to a point. It's not broken off, and it's short. The teeth, otherwise, are kind of similar to the Nutria and the Beaver. And once you get used to it, there's some details that are a little different about the porcupine teeth. But just superficially, they do look kind of similar to these other two. But as I said, with the Beaver is sciuromorphous, so there's no confusion there. And then the length of the periocipital processes will help with the Nutria. All right, moving on to the porcupine pelt now. So porcupine pelts are pretty distinctive. You know, when I was picking this thing up, it's poking me because it has all these quills in here. The quills are kind of aiming toward the back, and the porcupine can kind of keep them laid down like this, or it can make them go erect, start swishing its tail around and try to hit a predator in the face or something. So when they're faced with a predator, they'll puff up all these quills and they'll kind of lunge at them backwards if they feel cornered, try to get the predator to bite their back, and then they get a mouthful of quills, which can be very dangerous. They do have some predators though, like fishers will kill porcupines. Some other predators get pretty good at it. They learn how to bite them on the snout or flip them over. I don't know how they learn that without getting a mouthful of quills, but some of them seem to succeed in doing that. So that's a quick overview of these rodent families: the Aplodontiidae, the Castoridae, the Myocastoridae, and then the porcupine. Actually, I forgot to mention the name of the porcupine, Erethizon dorsatum, in the family Erethizontidae, and it's the only North American species in that family. There are some other species in that family, but not in North America. So the Erethizontidae, Erethizon dorsatum. Now here, I want to approach this from a little bit different angle. We've been talking about these rodents, and several of them are aquatic rodents. So here I have three species of aquatic rodents and another aquatic animal, the river otter, Lontra canadensis. And so what I want to talk about is, how can you identify an aquatic rodent? You see a large mammal swimming in the water, how can you tell what it is? And so with the beaver or the Nutria, they actually swim kind of similarly. They're along the surface of the water. And so then I try to look for the tail. Of course, with a beaver, you can look for telltale signs like a beaver dam, a beaver lodge, gnawed trees that have been cut down. And then you got a pretty good clue that there's a beaver in the area. But you could have both beavers and Nutrias. And so the tail is a really good clue. And you often can see that when they're swimming on the surface of the water. And if the beaver is alarmed, they will dive and slap the surface of the water with their tail, making a loud noise. So that can also help you identify the beaver. Muskrats are smaller, and if you see them swimming around on the surface, they're kind of I tend to see them moving around more erratically than a beaver or a Nutria. Plus, they're about half the size. They have a small tail, and the tail of the muskrat is what we call laterally compressed. It's flat and vertically taller than it is horizontally. This gives it what we call a keel, kind of a ridge, so it can use it for steerage. It's also hairless. So the muskrat has a flat, hairless tail, while the Nutria has a round tail that's almost hairless but has some hair on it. Now that could be hard to tell when you're seeing them from a distance, but if you get a good look at the tail, then that can help you pick them out. Otherwise, the muskrat is quite a bit smaller than the Nutria, unless it's a juvenile Nutria, and swims a little differently. Now, what about the otter? How can you tell an otter from these other animals? Well, otters, this one right here is a juvenile. Here's an adult river otter. You can see it's quite a bit larger. But the otter has a somewhat wide, very furry tail, different from all these other animals. And the other thing about otters is they're long and narrow and very flexible. And so I rarely see them just cruising along the surface of the water like a beaver or a nutria. And if they are, they'll often stick their head up out of the water and look around. You'll never see a beaver or a nutria, at least I've never seen a beaver or a nutria stick their head up out of the water and look around like an otter will do. I don't think they're flexible enough to do it. So otters will often be looking around above the water when they're on the surface, and then they'll dive under. When they dive, they're very sleek and agile. So if you can just watch one for a second move around, you'll probably be able to tell that it's an otter. Plus, then the tail is quite distinctive because it's much thicker and furrier than any of these other aquatic animals. Of course, it's not a rodent. The otter is a carnivore, eats fish and or carnivora, whereas these others are herbivorous rodents. But you often will see a large mammal, brown mammal swimming in the water, or at least I will, and I'll go, what kind of mammal is that? So I wanted to give you some clues for picking that out in the field. All right, so that wraps up this video, basically an introduction to the rodent families with some discussion of aquatic mammals.